It's Antioch Live on your radio at WBGX 1570 AM and online at gospel1570.com, ambcchicago.org, YouTube, and Facebook Live. Featuring our lead pastor, the Reverend Dr. Gerald M. and our digital pastor, Reverend Terrell Carter.
Hello and welcome to Antioch Live. It is Sunday, December the 27th. It's the last Sunday of the year. Can you believe it? We're so happy to have you with us. And we want to say a special shout out to Harmony Community Church, Pastor James Brooks, who's worshiping along with us in the greater Lawndale community. We're so happy for our sister church worshiping with us on this last Sunday of the year. Go ahead, like, comment, share, call somebody and invite them to worship right now. I want to open up with scripture. Psalm 95 says, "Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalm. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods." Shall we pray? Our Father and our God, how we thank you for your faithfulness. I know we've been saying that for a while now, but it's true. You have been faithful. You've looked past our faults and met our needs. You protected us. You watched over us and you've walked with us through this incredible and crazy year. And so God, we've come just to say thank you. We thank you for life, health, and strength. We thank you for all of those who are listening and connected to this broadcast. Father God, we pray that you would bless those who are sick, shut in, incarcerated, wherever this broadcast is going. God, invade that place with your hope and with your miracle working power. We thank you for our pastor and we lift up Reverend Dr. Gerald M. as he stands to deliver the word on today. Bless us through the word and help us to be receptive hearers. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I know this year has been incredible, but God has been faithful and he's allowed us to be able to come into your home, into your space, wherever you are with the word of God. And we thank you so much for connecting with us. We're going to have a moment of worship. And so after you've liked, you've commented, you shared, I need you to back up. I need you to really engage in worship, open up your mouth and sing praises unto our God. And then we're getting ready for the word from our lead pastor here at the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, Reverend Dr. Gerald M. Come on, Antioch. Come on, Harmony. Come on, all of our family and friends. Let's go to worship right now.
Good morning, and God bless you. What a wonderful day it is to be alive. Amen. We're here today, and it is the last Sunday in 2020, Sunday, December the 27th. Listen, today is a very special service because we're sharing our worship service with our sister church and our brother in Christ, Reverend James Brooks, and the Harmony Community Church family. And we just thank God to be sharing with the Harmony family, Antioch and Harmony. We're together again. Normally, we would have had some kind of fellowship service, I think in November or October of this year, but because of COVID-19, we were not able to do it. And so because of technology, we're able to share in this combined service of worship on this last Sunday in the year. And so I just want to greet the Harmony Community Church family and Antioch. You know we love you. Thank both congregations for this opportunity to bring God's house into your house and to share God's word with you. Again, hats off to my friend and brother, our member, Pastor James Brooks. We certainly thank God for you and the power of your ministry there on in the Lawndale community. And we just thank God and we pray his richest blessings upon you and First Lady Jackie and to all of the members of your family and the Harmony Community Church family as well. Amen. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. And so we want to go to the Word of God and just share some principles out of his word on this last Sunday in the year. Let me take a minute, though, and just thank the Antioch family for the great outpouring of love during the Christmas celebration and the observance of the 61st anniversary of my birth. Amen. We had a great time. Thank God for Jan Green and all of the other persons, our First Lady, and all of the other persons that shared in making that celebration as fun and as wonderful as it was. May God return to you 100-fold all of the love and blessings that you so bountifully bestowed upon me and us during that holiday, Christmas and birthday celebration. Amen. Amen. I want to talk about today lessons from the wise, lessons from the wise. As we conclude this year and stand on the threshold of going into a brand new year, I'm led by the Holy Spirit to just share some lessons from the wise. Since today is the last Sunday of 2020, and God knows this has been an incredible year. We've had to deal with COVID-19. We've had to practice social distancing, sometimes even in our own homes. We had to distance ourselves from some of our relatives that live even in the house with us. There have been protests directed towards police brutality. Some of those protests after dark would be hijacked by persons that had other motives. They wanted to rob and loot and steal. There was violence in the streets. We've had to deal with schools being closed, churches being closed, curfews being administered. There's even been both an admission and a denial of systemic racism. Some people have admitted, yes, it does exist. Some people are still living in denial that it does not exist. This year has been an incredible year. Over 286,000 Americans have died from COVID-19, that coronavirus. We even went through a presidential election, and we've witnessed the historical election of Kamala Harris, a woman of color, as vice president-elect. And certainly, we're praying for president-elect Joe Biden and the team that he is selecting. It is still questionable whether or not there will be a transfer, a peaceful transfer of power. That's yet to be seen. So it has been an incredible year. And as we come to the close of this most tumultuous year, and we're even facing the uncertainties of the coming year, there are some wise men whose actions provides a few lessons for us as we go forward. And so I want to share these lessons from the wise. The record of their actions are recorded, the record of their actions is recorded in Matthew chapter number 2. I want to read verses 1 and 2, and then I want to read verses 11 and 12. The text says, "Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he that is born king of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him.'" Verse 3 is saying, read me. "When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him." Reading now verses 11 and 12. "And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way." Thus ends the reading of God's holy word. Jesus, Matthew tells us, was born in Bethlehem in the days of Herod the king. This is actually Herod the Great. Herod the Great was made king. He was made king by the Roman Senate. His family was from Edom and converted to Judaism. Although Herod the Great is credited for his building projects in Judea and Jerusalem, his character was flawed. His morals were questionable, and his actions at times were destructive. But Herod was still king. I think we've had that experience of persons being in high places and occupying chief seats, while at the same time having flaws in their character and having morals that are questionable and having actions that are destructive and divisive, and yet they occupy seats of authority and seats of power. Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king. And Matthew shares with us that there were wise men that came from the east to Jerusalem seeking him who was born king of the Jews. Listen, Herod was made king, but they were looking for one who was born king. In their search, they were not deterred by time. They were not deterred by distance, for they had seen his star in the east. They had seen a sign of his presence. They had seen a sign of his coming. They had seen a sign of his birth. And they were moved by that sign. They saw his star, and they followed the star. They came seeking the one that was born king. Their arrival was approximately 2 years after the birth of Jesus Christ. It was about 2 years after the birth of Christ that these wise men arrive in Jerusalem asking the question, where is he that is born King of the Jews? Listen, the first lesson that we learn from these wise men is that as we conclude this year, and as we go into a year of uncertainty, the first lesson we learn from these wise men is it is important to look for the King. Look for the one who was born King. Look for Jesus. Now, for these wise men, they looked for him in what was an obvious place to them. They looked for him in Jerusalem. And the fact that they looked for him in Jerusalem and they asked the question, where is he that is born King of the Jews? That particular question was concerning to Herod, and it was concerning to the citizens of Jerusalem. As a matter of fact, it was more than concerning. That question was troubling because Herod was thinking in his mind, how can there be another king when I'm already king? But brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, there is such a stark contrast between Herod, who was made king, and Christ, who was born king. Herod may have had the citizenship of Jerusalem on his side, but Christ has the host of heaven on his side. Herod may have had earthly strength and power, but Christ has heavenly strength and heavenly power. He has the very power of God in his hands. What a stark contrast from the one that occupied the earthly seat of authority and one that occupies the heavenly seat of authority. There's a difference between being made king and being born king. That question troubled Jerusalem, and it troubled King Herod. And so he gathered together, the Bible says he gathered together all of the chief priests and scribes of the people, and they began to inquire, where is Christ to be born? Where is the one who is born king? Where is he to be born? And they did their research, and of course they found the prophetic writings in the Old Testament that said that he would be born in Bethlehem, Bethlehem of Judea, the city of David, Bethlehem. And so Herod, after calling together the scribes and the chief priests and getting that information, then he called into his private chamber those wise men from the east. And he shared with them, that Bethlehem is the place that they should look for the one that was born king. Herod was very concerned about the timing of the appearance of the star, because he wanted to kind of measure how old this child would be. And the king, Herod, says to these wise men, listen, you go on into Bethlehem and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, then come back and let me know so that I can go and worship him. Listen, these wise men, they were seeking the one that was born king because they had an objective in their mind. They had come to worship him. They had come to pay homage to him. They had come to bow down to him. Matthew says that when they had finished speaking with King Herod, that they left heading to Bethlehem, and the star that they had seen in the east appeared again, and it stood over the place where the young child was. The Bible says that when they saw the sign of him again, that they began to rejoice because they knew they were about to encounter the one that they had been looking for. Lesson number one from the wise men is look for the one that is born king. Now, they looked for him in Jerusalem. They looked for him in Bethlehem. But listen, we have the opportunity now, my brothers and sisters, to look for him everywhere. You can look for him as you move about your daily tasks. You can look for him in the supermarket. You can look for him at the gas station. You can look for him while you're doing your online banking. You can look for him in the Zoom call meeting. You can look for him everywhere. You can look for him on the Eisenhower. You can look for him on the Dan Ryan. You can look for him. Look for the King. One scripture in the Bible says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. You know what? If you look for him, you can see his fingerprints in creation. If you look for him, you can see him in the wind that's blowing. If you look for him, you can see him in the snowflakes that are falling. If you look for him, you'll see him even in your brothers and sisters in Christ. If you look for him, you'll find him. So throughout this coming year, as you navigate these uncharted waters of 2021, look for the one that is born King. Listen, when they found him, they came into the house. They came into the house and they saw the young child. Listen, these wise men, and let me just say this, that many nativity scenes show the wise men at the stable. Listen, Jesus was not at the stable when the wise men showed up. Sometimes they'll show the wise men bowing down at the manger with a baby Jesus still wrapped in swaddling clothes. Listen, that's not where they met this young child. He was in a house. He was a young child. He was not a babe. He was not wrapped in swaddling clothes. He was not lying in a manger, but they found him. And when they found him, the Bible says that they came into where he was and they fell down and they worshiped him. They worshiped him at the place that they found him. Listen, that's lesson number two. Lesson number one is look for him. Seek the one that is born King. And then when you find him, worship him. Bow down and worship him. If you find him at the supermarket, worship him at the supermarket. If you find him on the Dan Ryan, worship him on the Dan Ryan. If you find him at your place of employment, worship him at your place of employment. Now, they literally fell down, bowed down on their knees. They paid homage. They bowed before him. They showed him reverence. And sometimes we may not be able to physically bow, but you can bow in your spirit. Sometimes you might not be able to physically kneel down before the presence of God. But listen, you can kneel down in your spirit. And wherever you find him, I just believe you ought to worship him. Wherever you encounter him, you ought to worship him. Wherever you experience him, you ought to celebrate him and praise him and bless his name. Amen. Look for him. And then when you find him, worship him. Worship him. And then the third lesson that we learn from these wise men is that they gave gifts unto him. They brought gifts unto him. These are some incredible gifts. They are three in number. And sometimes we think that the number of gifts equates the number of wise men. We don't know how many wise men it was. It could have been 10 wise men. It could have been 30 wise men. It could have been 3 wise men. It could have been 50 wise men. We don't know how many wise men it was, but we do know there were 3 different types of gifts. The first gift that was given was gold. Gold is certainly a gift fit for a king. And these gifts, my brothers and sisters, had as much to do with the person that was receiving the gifts as it had to do with the persons that were giving the gifts. This gift of gold on the recipient end had to do with the fact that Christ Jesus was born King, and gold is certainly a gift fit for a king. But on the part of the giver, gold symbolizes substance or livelihood. And what these wise men were literally doing was not just honoring the royalty of Christ and the divinity of Christ and the kingship of Christ, but they then were offering to him their substance and their livelihood. Sometimes that's the biggest thing that keeps us separated from God is our substance and our livelihood. Remember the rich young ruler who wanted to know what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus told him, sell all you have, give it to the poor, and come follow me. And that rich man dropped his head and walked off in despair because he was not willing to offer his substance. The wise men gave him gold. Listen, if you're going to give a gift to Christ, give him your substance, give him your livelihood. Give him those things that mean the most to you, for he is certainly deserving of all that we have. Not only did they give gold, but they gave frankincense. The sweet fragrance, this sweet fragrance of incense that really is deserving. A king deserves to be in a place where the aroma is sweet. But this frankincense not only symbolizes the sweet fragrance for the king, but on the part of the giver, it has to do with the inner life. So the gold representing the substance and livelihood, the frankincense, my inner life, my thoughts, my passions, my will. He said, listen, when you come and bow before the king, offer him your substance, offer him your livelihood, offer him your inner life, offer him your thoughts, offer him your heart, offer him your passions, offer him your desires. He's the king, and he deserves all that we are and all that we have. And then that third gift, they gave him myrrh. Myrrh was a precious and expensive gift. And the uniqueness of myrrh is that it was used to prepare bodies for burial. This gift must have been very well a prophetic gift, recognizing that he did come, but he came to die, and he came to die for the sins of the world. He came to offer himself as a sacrifice on the hill called Calvary. He came as the Lamb of God to give his life, and myrrh was given to him in a prophetic way, recognizing that one day he would die. But just like he died, we know the end of the story. Early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. And so for the recipient of myrrh, it had to do with Jesus and his death. But on the part of the giver, myrrh symbolizes all that causes sorrow, all that causes us to experience bitterness, all that causes tears to come into our eyes. And so when we bow before him, we ought to give him our sorrows. Give him those things that causes us bitterness. Give him the tears. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. We learn from these wise men these three lessons as we conclude this year and move into 2021. Look for him who was born king. Look for him. And wherever you find him, that's the place to bow down and worship him. And a part of worship is offering gifts to him. Give him your substance and your livelihood. Give him your inner life, your passions, your dreams, your desires. Offer up to him all the things that would cause you sorrow and bitterness and tears. Just give it all to him. And when we shall have done that, then we will also have this concluding experience that the wise men had. For after they found him and after they worshiped him and after they gave gifts to him, they were about to return to Herod. But the angel of the Lord warned them, do not return to Herod. And so what they did was they returned to their own country. The Bible says another way. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, there will be a change in your life, and you'll be able to go forward another way after you have found him. You'll be able to go forward another way after you have worshiped him. You'll be able to go forward another way after you have given him your substance and your livelihood, your inner life, your passions and dreams, after you've given him the things that may cause you sorrow and bitterness and tears, after you've had that encounter with him, you too can continue your life another way, with another way of living, another way of rejoicing, another way of celebrating, another way of engaging with one another. Christ brings about a change and causes us to live our lives another way. These are just a few lessons from the wise. God bless you, and thank you, Harmony. God bless you, and Happy New Year.
We praise God for that word on today. God can literally send you another way. God can literally change your life as you come into the presence of Jesus. And if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, listen, you can end the year off strong. You can admit that you're a sinner. You can believe that Christ died on the cross for your sins. You can confess him as Lord. And the Bible says, all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And so I want to encourage you, make Jesus your choice. End this year off right. Be a part of the family of God. Your life will never be the same. You can reach out to us through our website. You can call the number. You can send us a direct message. We want to connect with you, and we want to make sure you end the year strong. I also want to encourage you to go ahead and give. You know you can give to Antioch a few different ways. You can go to our newly designed website, ambcchicago.org. Click on that giving tab and you can give there. You can give through the Givelify app. Download that app from your app store and search for Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, and you can give there. You can mail or drop off your donation to our church, Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, 415 West Englewood, Chicago, Illinois, 60621. You can also call the church number at 773-873-4433, and you can make arrangements for your gift to be picked up, and you can give through Zelle using the email address antiochchurchchicago@gmail.com. We appreciate Harmony for worshiping with us on today. Like I said, this has been an incredible year, and what a way to end it. And listen, the next time we see you, it'll be into the next year. And so I just want us to bow our heads for a word of prayer as we close out and thank God for all that he's done. Our Father and our God, we thank you once again. Every time we think of your goodness and your faithfulness, we can't help but to say thank you. God, we thank you for how you've allowed us to move forward. God, we thank you for how you've allowed ministry to still go forward. Father, we thank you how you have moved and how you blessed us to be a blessing in the midst of the hard times of 2020. God, we give you praise because we acknowledge that we made it only because of your grace and your mercy. So, Father, we pray that you would bless Harmony in an incredible way and in all the ways you're moving through that ministry. God, we pray that you'll bless Antioch in all the ways that you're helping us to touch others. God, help us to even go harder and to even be able to do more as we cross over into 2020. We give your name praise. We give your name honor. We give your name glory. And we thank you for the miracles you've done, and we thank you for the miracles you're yet to perform. It's in Jesus' name we pray, with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen. We thank you for joining us for this edition of Antioch Live. Thank you for being connected. Stay connected. God is still going to do some incredible things. Thank you so much. This is your digital pastor, Terrell Carter, and we'll see you the first Sunday of the year. Have your communion ready. We'll talk to you then.
Thank you for joining Antioch Live. We appreciate our faithful listeners and viewers for your support for 60 years. Tell your family, tell your friends, join us every Sunday at 8 o'clock a.m. Until next time, may God bless all of you real good.